joining us. For those that are live streaming from home, my name is Nisa Cardin. I'm a child neurologist and a pediatric neuromuscular specialist. And thanks for those who made the trip out here. Thanks for those that are checking it out from home. And thanks to Casey Circle for allowing us to do this. We're going to be talking about spinal muscular atrophy, what I would call the basics and the latest. There are a lot of new things that are really important things that have come out recently for spinal muscular atrophy. So I thought it was going to be a good topic to choose. Bear with me. We're going to go over some in order to sort of understand these things. There's a lot of sort of genetics and molecular biology that we have to dive into. So just bear with me and be patient. And you know, since this is a small group setting, feel free to just break in with questions. Don't feel, you know, feel like this is a very formal thing.
Do you want to let her kind of update anybody in Spanish?
Oh, yeah, for sure. So we're going to talk about five different things. We're going to review the symptoms of spinal muscular atrophy, what we call SMA, abbreviated. We're going to categorize four types of the condition. We're going to understand the genetic and molecular basis of the condition, like I was telling you guys or warning you. We're going to learn the mechanism for the recently FDA-approved treatment called nusinersen or Spinraza, which has a very novel mechanism, and I think is I really hope is going to change, you know, not only with for SMA but for several conditions that we as humans face. And we'll take a very brief peek into future treatments that are currently in research trials.
Se va a repasar los síntomas, las cuatro categorías y también los entender los genéticos y las mecanismos aprobadas por el FDA y también un poco en el tratamiento que se está procesando ahorita.
Y los tratamientos en el futuro que están desarrollando, ¿ok? All right, and just basically, you know, the symptoms that may make a neurologist think about a diagnosis of SMA. You know, whenever we evaluate a child and we see that they are hypotonic or they have low tone, meaning they're not giving you much resistance when you passively move their arms and legs. If they have weakness, and that's more leg weakness more than arms, and we call proximal more than distal weakness. So weakness that's more around the shoulder and around the hips compared to the hands or the feet. So I'll repeat what the definition of hypotonia is. So it's basically low resistance when someone is passively moving your arms and legs. You know, the other things that we might see are some difficulty feeding, failure to thrive, not being able to gain weight well in infancy, respiratory insufficiency, meaning weakness of the chest wall muscles, not being able to breathe well, tongue fasciculations, which is quivering, very particular quivering movements of the could be any muscles, but in particular when we see that it happens in the tongue, that is a classic sign for loss of nerve innervation to the tongue, and then problems in developing motor skills. So children who, you know, are otherwise very aware, are, you know, cooing, babbling, then talking, but they're just not doing as well in their motor skills. So they're not sitting, they're not rolling, maybe they don't walk on time, things like that.
With the tongue, what was it again?
Fasciculations, it's like abnormal involuntary movements of the tongue.
Movimientos de la lengua son involuntarios. Y los motor skills.
So problems in developing. So for instance, if a child doesn't sit on time or doesn't walk on time. But they're otherwise developing their language skills, their social skills well. So here the picture that I chose for this slide shows you a very young infant with SMA, likely type 1, who has a very narrow chest and kind of has a flailing out of the abdomen. So just showing that the respiratory muscles, the breathing muscles, are so weak that the chest isn't expanding well. And the baby is using all of his abdominal muscles to try to breathe.
Sorry, can you
sure. So in this picture, we see that this is a baby with a very narrow chest.
Es un bebé con un pecho muy chiquito.
And that's because he or she has very weak muscles in his chest.
Es porque tiene los músculos muy débiles.
And he can't breathe because he just has that weakness. He can't breathe.
Y no puede respirar porque sus músculos son muy débiles.
So he's using his abdominal muscles to breathe.
So está usando su estómago para poder respirar.
So SMA, this condition, affects 1 in 11,000 live births, so 1 in 11,000 newborn babies, making it the most common inherited motor neuron disease of childhood.
So es afecta 1 in 11,000 niños. Y es el más común
neuromuscular.
Neuromuscular.
Okay. There are 4 different types of SMA, type 1 through 4, and are basically or historically categorized based on how severe the child's symptoms are and what their level of development is.
So son 4 tipos de SMA y varían en que de la dificultad de cada que es la severidad de cada síntoma.
So type 1 being the most severe, type 4 being the least severe.
Tipo 1 es el más severo y el 4 es el menos severo.
So the quick way that I was taught, or like the easy way to sort of remember this, is type 1, patients with type 1 SMA never sit. Patients with type 2 SMA will sit, but they never walk. Patients with type 3 will sit, they'll walk, but they won't run. And patients with type 4 can sit, walk, but have some mild difficulty with running.
Uno no puede, se puede sentar, se puede sentar. El tipo 2 puede, solo se sienta. El tipo 3 se sienta y camina, pero tiene dificultades
de correr.
Y tipo 4 tiene todos, pero
tiene más dificultad de correr. So obviously this is not 100% for every patient, and there is a wide variety of symptoms, but this is kind of the basic category. For type 1, classically, you know, we as neurologists have been taught that this is a condition that is fatal by about 2 years of age. Again, there's some variation there, and that you know, life can be prolonged for children with type 1 if they go on mechanical ventilation, like on a breathing machine, continuously or for several hours of the day, and get G-tube feed, so get artificial feeding, nutrition.
El tipo 1 es fatal para la edad de 2 años, pero todavía pueden prolongar la vida si tienen por los tubos incubados en los tubos de respiración And what was the other one after the tubing?
Help with feeding, como un tubo para alimentación. But the other type 2, type 3, and type 4 are not necessarily life shortening.
Los otros tipos todavía pueden vivir
con otras cosas. Types 2 through 4. There's levels of kind of cerebral palsy that I know that's a general term. Where you could look, for instance, you could look at number 4 and you could say somebody has these symptoms, but for CP they would have those symptoms. How's the differentiation? I know you said one's inherited, maybe the other one's injury related, or?
Yeah, so SMA is a specific diagnosis or a specific condition that affects just the motor neurons and is a genetic condition. And so we'll go into what the diagnosis is and how we are able to sort of prove or even confirm our suspicion when we see a patient with subtle symptoms that could be multiple things.
Okay.
Right, so you're right. But we'll go into how the diagnosis is made.
Okay.
Sí, yo creo que yo tengo el tipo 1 y el 4.
She thinks she has type 1 and 4.
Tengo dos. Dos bebés, dos niños.
Tiene dos bebés.
Okay,
two babies, sorry.
Sí. Pero.
We're keeping on jobs today.
A mí nunca me han dado ese diagnóstico para del tipo 1, porque tengo un niño de que no se sienta a lo mejor por máximo dos minutos.
So
pero no camina ni gatea. Pero nunca me han dado el diagnóstico de SM.
Right, so this is a specific diagnosis that is made by a genetic test. It's a separate condition. There are lots of conditions that can cause a child to not sit or to not walk or to not crawl, but this is a specific condition that has a genetic diagnosis or a genetic test to confirm the diagnosis. So you know, a neurologist who is evaluating your child would be able to, distinguish or have an idea, perhaps based on the symptoms or based on hearing the story, whether SMA is something to be considered or not. And so it may be, I mean, there, again, not being having problems in your development could be from lots of different things, and that's why, that's what we as neurologists are trained in, to distinguish, when a child has a problem in their development, what may be the underlying reason for that. And this is just one reason for a child to have problems with sitting or crawling or walking.
She asked when would she be referred to a neurologist?
Talk to your pediatrician and or your primary doctor. To find out if the symptoms that your child is having would require a neurologist to evaluate him or her.
It was referring the pediatrician can refer it, and then from there, what happens?
If you're pediatrician thinks that there, yes, there could be a neurologic condition underlying, then your pediatrician will refer you to a neurologist who can talk to you and hear the whole story for the child, the history, and evaluate the child with an exam, and then decide.
My son have two neurologists, Q and O.
Okay. Okay.
But I never see that.
I think she's trying to find out when do they refer her out, because she hasn't gone, so she's asking how soon do they send you to see a neurologist. He's two.
I think she's got two neurologists.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you can talk to Dr. Ong and Dr. Keough.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, let me tell you more about the condition. You can see if it makes sense for your. All right, so there is one other type of SMA called type 0, which is considered to be fatal prenatally, meaning children die in the womb or they die within the first 6 months of life. So it's the most severe form.
So hay un tipo 0 que es el más fatal y es que eso ocurre cuando el bebé todavía está en el vientre.
More than 95% of children with SMA inherit those SMA-related genes from their parents. So this is a genetic condition.
So it's a condition,
but it's not completely genetic.
It's a genetic condition.
Oh, okay. So the other five is just
whatever.
Prepare.
Over 95% inherit. The other 5% don't inherit. Oh, but it's still genetic.
The other 5% have a change in their genes that just happened spontaneously in their cells and is not actually being inherited from their parents.
Okay.
But the vast majority of their patients are getting it from their parents. So to just give you the basic understanding of chromosomes and genes, these are our chromosomes. So as humans, we have 23 pairs of chromosomes. These chromosomes have all of our genes on it, coded. We have every set, for the most part, we have every set of like this in each of the cells in our body.
Tenemos 23 cromosomas en nuestro cuerpo, en el mundo de esta persona.
23 pairs of chromosomes.
Tres pares de cromosomas en nuestro cuerpo.
In every cell in our body.
En cada célula de nuestro cuerpo.
And they have genes, the chromosomes have genes in them.
Las cromosomas tienen genes.
Genes, you know, you see, because we have pairs, so we get one copy from our mother, one copy from our father, and that's why we have two of everything.
Okay, so tenemos una copia de nuestros padres y una copia de nuestros de nuestra madre, y por eso tenemos dos. That's why we have two, right? Y por eso tenemos dos copias. Y quería preguntarle que cuando cambia.
Yeah, cuando dice que, como por ejemplo estaban hablando del 5%, cuando dicen que este es como cambian antes de nacer.
She was asking when does the chromosomes change or the gene change?
That's complex. It can happen at any step of the way. Are you talking about the children who don't inherit the condition from their parents?
Yes, talking about the 5%.
Yeah. So it can happen almost at any step of the way. It can happen, it can happen at any step of the way. So, but during development.
Puede ocurrir en cualquier momento durante el desarrollo.
During the pregnancy, as the fetus is growing. But typically we talk about it happening early on, so either in that first cell of the baby, and then all of the cells of the baby would have that gene change.
So, aparece cuando están embarazadas en la primera célula del embarazo, y ya después de cuando empiezan a salir las otras, algo ya está cambiando.
All right, so we have 23 pairs, one copy from mom, one copy from dad. So this just gives you a schematic. Instead of looking at 23 pairs, we're just looking at one pair to represent all of our genes. So look, dad's got two copies of this chromosome here, mom's got two copies of this chromosome here, and when they have a child, they can have four different combinations if we're tracking one particular chromosome or one particular gene. So when we think about our genes, I like to think of it as a recipe book for how to make proteins in our cells and how to get our cells to function normally.
So cuando piensas de los genes, lo piensa como una receta, de que cómo funcionan and how do they function in our.
They give recipes to make proteins and to. To determine sort of how our cell functions are happening. So, if we talk about, our DNA, is what makes up our genes, our chromosomes, so all of those things we can sort of think for now interchangeably. And that is sort of like a recipe. So, for instance, if you're making a cake, it'll tell you 2 cups flour, 1 cup sugar, 2 eggs, 1 teaspoon vanilla. I don't have a recipe at home that says this, but I simplified it. So I'm not making cakes like this. But But so that is sort of the DNA. Our genes are sort of like a master recipe book. And every time that you want to cook something, you don't go to the library and, you know, do an investigation in the encyclopedia for a recipe or anything. You're going to make a copy of the recipe and just have it with you, right? And so that sort of copy is the RNA, and that RNA gets translated into an amino acid or a protein chain, with that, which then gets modified and folded into a protein, and that's actually what is helping our cells function.
So el genes son como una receta, ¿no? Va a hace una copia y es cuando forma la RNA, y después
it gets made into an amino acid or protein chain.
Y luego se nos hace
it's like modified and folded into a protein.
Y luego se modifica para hacer un protein.
So you can imagine, if we're talking about a recipe, if you have a typo in that recipe, then your cake is not going to come out right. So let's say you have a deletion and you're missing the word flour. Well, now it's 2 cups of, and maybe the, you know, cake doesn't turn out right. If you have a misspelling, then maybe instead of sugar it says sumac, and your cake is not going to turn out right. And then let's say you have a duplication, it says 2 eggs, and your cell gets confused and your cake doesn't come out right. So any typo can cause a problem in the way that your protein is being made and then the way that it's actually functioning, and that can be a really important thing for your cells.
So, si estamos viendo como una receta, si algo se cambia, algo va a estar mal porque no se transfiere correctamente, y eso hace que cambie cada nuestros genes.
So, now getting back to the condition SMA, the gene that gets changed in this condition, or that has a typo essentially in it, is called survival motor neuron, and we abbreviate it to be SMN. This is located on chromosome 5, so this guy all the way at the top right. And we don't completely understand why, but it is very important for, this protein is very important for the health and survival and function of our motor neurons.
Okay, so el error donde se funciona, el error que está es en el
survival motor neuron.
Yes, pronunciado a mi nombre. So, yes, survival motor neuron, no sé cómo se pronuncia. Pero esa está en la cromosoma número 5, y esta de la esquina. Yes. What was after?
We don't know why, but yeah. It's very important for the survival and the function of our motor neurons.
No sabemos por qué, pero es importante para nuestro la sobrevivencia de nuestros neuronas.
So our motor neurons are nerve cells that start in our spinal cord, go through our peripheral nerves in our arms, in our legs, and then make connections with our muscles, tell our muscles to contract so that we can actually move our hands, move our feet, move our arms, everything.
So hacen nos dan signos para la columna, los pies, and our heads.
Esas células están como en parte de los nervios que están de la espina dorsal por el la espina dorsal, que están comunicando hasta los músculos en nuestros brazos, en las piernas, para decir a los músculos para contract, ¿me entiende? Para mover todo el cuerpo, ¿ya?
Yes.
Okay. This is a very important gene that makes a very important protein that's very important for our motor nerves. It's so important, in fact, that we actually have two versions of it. We have SMN1 and SMN2, both on this chromosome 5.
Okay, so esas son dos muy importantes, o tenemos dos, y es en la cromosoma
Same.
Cinco.
And there's actually just one letter difference. So in our genes, the code for writing your recipe is actually just four letters, A, C, T, and G. And the difference between these two genes, SMN1 and SMN2, is just one letter.
So la diferencia de esos dos genes es una letra.
That one difference is in such an important place. SMN1 gene makes more than 90% normal protein. So if you have just one copy of this SMN1 gene, you have sufficient protein, your nerve cells are healthy, no problem.
Tiene usted una copia de una de las proteínas, es decir, está
of this gene, SMN.
SMN.
You make plenty of good protein.
Haces mucha producción de la proteína.
We all have copies of SMN2 as a backup, but it only makes 10% normal protein.
Todos tenemos la SMN2.
Of protein.
Mm-hmm.
So for all of us here, I could sort of hypothesize that we all have at least one copy of SMN1 and that's sufficient. And so we don't have to rely on SMN2. Each of these genes has nine different sections, 1 through 8, but parts 2 were divided into 2A and 2B for another reason. We won't go into that. like I was telling you, just one letter difference, and that's in that section 7, which we call exon 7. There's a C in SMN1 at the same place that there is a T in SMN2.
So la diferencia está en la número 7, que se llama exon, y hay una C y la otra es una T.
From SMN1, when there's a C there, you're fine, you make the protein. This is my amino acid chain. No problem. From SMN2, that one T difference means that much of the time, you end up losing
exon 7.
And so that won't give you enough protein, so no good. Very, very few times with this T change do you end up getting exon 7 included, and you can make a small amount of normal protein.
So when we have the exon 7, no producimos mucha proteína, y después we still have the C, right?
Sometimes, even though there is a T here in SMN2, you can include this exon 7 and make a little bit of normal protein.
Okay. So when
so the majority of the time with SMN2, you're not making good functional protein. So we all really rely on SMN1 to give us sufficient functional protein. And like I said, if you just have one copy of SMN1 that's functioning well, we really are fine for the most part.
So casi siempre tenemos a SMN1, que es la que nosotros tenemos para producir la proteína buena. Necesitamos.
So what happens if your SMN1 gene has a typo? What if that recipe didn't come out right? Well, remember that we have two copies of every chromosome, of every gene, right? So let's say on one of those chromosomes, fifth chromosomes, we have a typo. So we've got the little X there, that SMN1 gene isn't working. Well, that's okay. We've got another copy, so we're okay, right?
So está hablando de los errores. ¿Qué pasa cuando hay un error en una de las cromosomas? Dice que cuando hay un error en la primera, está bien porque tenemos otra copia de los cromosomas.
So this shows you the same thing at a microscopic level. One SMN1 gene has a typo, but we've got the other one to rely on, so we really are still doing okay. And we get some bonus protein from SMN2, from the SMN2 gene. That's fine, not a problem, it's just bonus. So one copy of SMN1 is good enough.
So una copia de la SMN1 es bien porque hace suficiente proteína.
Now what happens if two people who have that same issue have a typo in one copy of SMN1, but the other copy is okay? What if they have a baby? They didn't know that they had this, perhaps because they never had symptoms, that one copy was good enough for them. But when they have a child, they have a 1 in 4 chance of having a child who has both copies with typos in it.
So I have a question. Was it both parents that have, okay.
Yeah.
So cuando los dos papás tienen un error en la cromosoma, respecto a la de SMN1 y la 2 que usan, y los dos quieren tener un hijo, but las chances de que su hijo pueda tener
these two?
Uh-huh.
Yes. These two children would be, or these two possibilities would be that the children would be just like their parents, that they have one gene with a typo and one gene that is fine, and they may not even know about it. They won't have any symptoms, and then they have a chance of passing it on to their children. But he would not have any symptoms, they would not have any symptoms, but she would have symptoms. This is not to say that you can only girls have SMA. This, I think this, it just shows you a split between boys and girls. So you know, now we're going to talk about this this child here who got both copies of SMN1 with typos in them. So this is what it would look like. That little baby would have a typo in one copy of SMN1 that he or she got from mom, one typo in SMN1 that he or she got from dad. But SMN2 is okay, but you remember SMN2 is sort of this backup gene. It's not doing as making as much SMN protein. So we're really, now this baby is relying on the SMN2 gene to make all of its functional protein, and that's going to be insufficient levels. And so that's really when you get into the problem with the motor neurons dying off, not working well, not communicating well, that your muscles are not getting good in communication to contract, and that gives you the low tone, the weakness. It gives you some respiratory weakness as well. It can give you the fasciculations and the tongue. It can depress your reflexes. It gives you the whole, all of the symptoms, all of the classic symptoms of SMA.
Okay, so ahora estamos hablando del bebito que tiene los síntomas. Sabemos que la SMN1 de la mamá no nos funciona y la copia del papá tampoco nos funciona, pero tenemos la extra copia de la SMN2, pero se acuerda que nada más produce 10%, so no produce tanta proteína que vamos a necesitar. So eso es lo que hace que
se causan los síntomas de esta condición, como la debilidad, la hipotonía, esas cosas. So the diagnosis for this condition, now we've gone over so much of genes and genetics, the diagnosis is a genetic test to look at whether there are any typos in the SMN1 gene.
So el diagnóstico es hacer un examen de los genes de la SMN1 para ver de dónde está el error en los genes.
Is that done with blood testing now, or is it still just muscle biopsies?
So we don't do muscle biopsies anymore for the diagnosis of SMA because we've gotten so good at doing the genetic test.
Okay.
And for the most part, it's done by by a blood sample. Okay. There are some labs that are starting to do them with just a cheek swab.
Oh, wow.
So you can just take like a not any Q-tip, but a Q-tip that's for the testing, and just rub it against the inside of your mouth, and then they get enough sort of cheek cells to test the DNA.
Con cotonete en la mejilla para agarrar suficiente prueba para hacer el examen.
You can tell I don't send the cheek swab very much because that's not part of my vocabulary.
Sí, con las células que te agarran de la
mejilla. So nowadays, we also, along with testing for whether that diagnosis is there in the SMN1 gene, we also look at how many copies of the SMN2 gene the patient might have. Una parte del diagnóstico. So, some patients have only two copies of SMN2 of that gene. Some patients will have three copies. Some patients have four copies. And that sort of, if you can imagine, maybe with more copies of SMN2, if each gene is giving you about 10% functional protein, okay, well then, yeah, maybe you get more and more functional protein the more copies of SMN2 you have, and maybe a few more motor neurons are surviving.
So, unas personas tienen nada más un SMN2, unos tienen dos, tres o cuatro, y a lo mejor eso puede funcionar porque puedes hacer suficiente proteína para poder funcionar bien.
So remember we were talking about four, maybe even five types of SMA?
So estamos hablando de los tipos de SMN.
So maybe, you know, the number of SMN2 copies could correlate with how severe your symptoms are.
So, estaba diciendo que a lo mejor los tipos de SMN2, depende de cuántos tenemos, puede variar también, depende de los tipos que tienen, desde el 0 al 4.
Y cómo severo están los síntomas. So, they've actually done several studies for this, and I'll kind of blow through this for the sake of time, but basically it looks like for the majority of patients with type 1, SMA, most of them have only one or two copies of SMN2. For type 2 patients, the ones who can sit but can't stand, can't walk, they may have, you know, mostly maybe three copies of SMN2. And then for type 3, the patients who can sort of walk but can't run, perhaps they have, you know, more like four or five and maybe even six copies of SMN2 gene. And so there is some variation. This isn't, obviously this isn't, you know, clear, strict, you know, guidelines here, but it gives you some degree of correlation.
Okay, so investigación y nada más la correlación de los
For like the number el número de los de las copias del segundo gene SMN2 y el tipo de SMA. Entonces si tiene solo uno o dos copias de SMN2 este gene, es probable que estos pacientes tuvo el tipo 1 de SMA, pero si tiene como tres copias de SMN2 más como el tipo 2 de SMA, entonces menos severos los síntomas, y los niños, los pacientes que tienen 4, 5, 6 copias de este gene SMN2 tiene el tipo 3 como menos severo de SMA.
¿Donde son los dos primeros? ¿Es como están menos severos? Cuando son los dos que están primero.
She's asking about the two first ones. Are they less severe or
no,
more severe?
No, esos son más severos.
Más severos.
Esos son tipo uno, que esos son los niños que no pueden sentarse. All right, so we'll kind of move a little bit faster through the management portion because I definitely want to hit the portion about the treatment, which I think is really incredible. But you know, basically, when you're managing or treating patients who have SMA, you really need to take a multidisciplinary approach, which is something that I think in medicine and pediatrics, but medicine in general, has been really pushed forward a lot more in the last decade. And certainly for neuromuscular conditions, which is you know what I am really passionate about, you know we have the help of the MDA to help us run our multidisciplinary clinics, so that our patients get evaluations, you know, hopefully more conveniently, but also with some more collaborative efforts from a pulmonologist, neurologist, an orthopedic doctor, a nutritionist, a physical therapist, an occupational therapist. I mean, with the sort of the mission statement of Casey's Circle, you guys are very familiar with this.
There's a lot of people.
Yeah, sort of preaching to the choir here. But so this has really, really been pushed forward, specifically with SMA, but also with you know any of our neuromuscular conditions. So we're gonna go forward to this incredible treatment that's come out called nusinersen or Spinraza, which the FDA approved at the end of 2016. It is the first, just the only, the first treatment for SMA, and from my experience, is just doing incredible things for our patients. It's soon, isn't it?
I think it's middle of June. Yeah. Right.
Not right now. So this is a particular kind of treatment called antisense oligonucleotide. We abbreviate it to be ASO. So just in case you know you come across that, that's it's basically describing what it does, or you know what I guess what it is, and sort of telling you a little bit about what it does, which I'll go through. So remember, not too long ago, we saw this slide, okay, where we looked at SMN1 and SMN2, and I told you the only difference was this one letter, C in SMN1 and T in SMN2, and that was really the key difference in how protein is made for each of those genes. What nusinersen is an 18-letter long chain. Like nucleotide or sort of RNA type chain that specifically binds to this sequence right here that includes the T. And it changes, you know, normally because of this T, most of your RNA, most of the copies of this gene that you would make would be missing that exon 7. But when you have this chain that binds to this area, you now get exon 7 included. Simple concept there, but just incredible how they got this to work.
So en ese es la tesa que está diferente, pero cuando agregas esa nueva línea que está en medio, ese ayuda a crear la exon 7 que estaba faltando.
And then we can make more functional protein. So you get much more functional protein that includes your exon 7. So again, we'll, you know, for the sake of time, we'll kind of run through this a little bit. But this was the pivotal trial that was a multi-center, so a clinical trial that was run at many different centers across the country with. The location where I did my fellow, where I was training in my fellowship at Stanford University, where you know, I was fortunate enough to be able to be a part of this and see you know, how this was being done and be able to, you know, take care of some of the patients that were in the trial and benefiting from the drug. Essentially, what we're seeing here is our gray bars being patients that were control subjects, meaning they were not getting the medication. We're seeing blue bars for patients who were getting the medication. And what we're seeing here being measured is a change in a motor functional scale. So the typical course for patients with SMA, which you can tell a little bit from the control group, is to decline over the course of several months. Whereas in our blue bars over here, those are patients that were receiving medication. Not only are they, for the most part, not declining, they're actually improving. So we were seeing patients who, before this medication, I would have counseled them to say, if you don't put your child on a ventilator, the chance of them living past their maybe second birthday is very, very low. And now we're seeing these same patients, these same children, sitting on their own, rolling over, or even some patients who have been walking with assistance, the last that I heard. So this is incredible. Like, this is an incredible difference.
Y los de la izquierda son los que tuvieron el medicamento, y miramos la diferencia en que los niños de la izquierda pudieron caminar o con asistencia solos o sentarse cuando los otros niños no pudieron.
Eso son midiendo un cambio en la escalera de función muscular. Entonces, los niños que tienen la condición y no tienen tratamiento con este química, tiene como calificaciones más bajos con tiempo, ¿okay? Pero los niños que tienen en azul, que tiene el tratamiento, que fue recibiendo el tratamiento, no es que están bajando, no es que están estable, están mejorando cada vez.
¿Qué tratamiento pueden ser las terapias?
Como terapia física, todo. Yeah, for sure. So she was just asking us, could this also be because of like physical therapy? So yes, so I'll tell you about that. Yeah.
How is it administered?
Yeah, like, so that becomes complicated. So this is a medication that is basically administered, what we call intrathecally. So it's through a spinal tap. So we put a needle in the lower back, below the end of the spinal cord, so that we're not injuring the spinal cord. It'd be similar to how some people get like lumbar punctures if they have meningitis, similar to how maybe a pregnant woman might get an epidural for when she's in labor. Similar, not exactly the same, but similar. Instead of putting medication to numb someone or taking a sample of the fluid in the back to check for infection, in this case, we're injecting medication that would get delivered to the spinal cord where these motor neurons are starting out. And from there, we see that they enter the cells and then bind to the DNA or to the gene, yeah, to the DNA, and then improve the amount of SMN protein, and then we see the symptoms change, improve.
How often do they get those shots?
We'll go over that.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
Yeah. Para entrar en las células que están parte de los nervios motores y están binding con la génica de SMN2 y cambiando la manera que esta receta está copiando, está produciendo proteína, está produciendo más proteína, está que los nervios están sobreviviendo más, están funcionando mejor y los síntomas están mejorando.
Cuando tu hijo tiene los músculos débiles, ¿por qué te hablan del botox?
Eso es diferente. Vamos a hablar después sobre este. Yeah. Eso es para una condición diferente de SMA. Yeah. En SMA no usamos botox.
Eso
lo
puedo usar yo.
I understood Botox.
I like what you guys are talking about.
Can't hide everything from Spanish speaker.
So all right. So although this looks incredible, right?
Yeah.
Children who don't receive the drug are plateauing or not doing well, and then children who do receive the drug are, you know, they're plateauing or for the most part getting better. That's incredible. You know, likely related to the medication, but you brought up, hey, you know, what are the other things that could be improving these children? When this study was done, they also looked at overall survival. They also looked at what they call event-free survival. So any major medical complication, whether it was a pneumonia, hospitalization for something, some other, infection that happened, things like that, they counted that as sort of an event and how many patients, didn't have any events. Well, you see that, in both groups, you see that they are still experiencing some complications.
Yeah.
So whether they receive the medication or not, there's still some patients who did pass away who were on nusinersen on the medication, but that was significantly less than the patients who didn't receive the medication, the control patients. And for event-free survival, you see the same thing. Patients who received the medication still struggled with complications, but they were not struggling maybe as much as the patients in the control group who didn't receive the medication. So there's still a lot of challenges for patients with SMA, even if they are receiving this medication. There's still a lot that has to be done to support their health, to support their development. So things such as physical therapy, following with a pulmonologist, and having good, what we call pulmonary toilet, but having good clearance of their respiratory system, managing their nutrition, making sure that they don't develop bad scoliosis, and that we address these things. All of these things are still really important. This is an incredible medication, but one thing that I do want to get across to everyone, and then specifically to the families of my patients with SMA, is that this is not a cure, and it's very dangerous for us to just prescribe the medication and say, you're done. You don't need to see me. You don't need to do your therapy. You don't need to see, your lung doctor. You don't need to see your orthopedic doctor. There's still a lot of things that have to be supported about our patient's health.
Estamos hablando de los grupos controlados y los que no estaban controlados y la diferencia de que hay. Y también estaba hablando, aunque sí es, no es una cura el medicamento, pero sí con ayuda de psicoterapeuta, cómo comen y cosas así pueden ayudarnos,
como la alimentación y visitas, una evaluación con pulmonólogo, de ortopedista, para ver cómo está la espalda, que esos niños tienen escoliosis también. Entonces todavía es muy importante para notar estas cosas y para prevenir complicaciones y para just support their health. We don't have time to go into that.
I know.
It was going to be in there, but any condition that causes weakness can cause scoliosis or can allow scoliosis to happen. But there are plenty of patients who don't have weakness who can develop mild scoliosis as well. Our patients who have a lot of weakness tend to have more scoliosis, more severe scoliosis. So you were asking about how the medication is dosed. So we talked about it being an intrathecal, or we call it, you know, an infusion through a spinal tap, an infusion into the spinal fluid that circulates around the spinal cord and around the brain. The dosing was based on, from what I understand, initially based on mouse model studies, animal model studies, and then sort of translated into human trials, which is, and this is the schedule that was trialed in these, you know, the important trials. And so this is what we're sticking to right now. The after the first dose, or I guess the first three doses are separated by 2 weeks. Following that, you have a month separation, so about 4 weeks. And then after that fourth dose, you go into a cycle of every 4 months, you get a dose. And for now, we think that this would be repeated indefinitely. We've only studied this drug in humans for a few years, and so we don't know if perhaps after getting several cycles of the every 4 months treatment, if there is a point at which a patient might plateau and may not have any more benefit from the medication, or if they might just continue to improve. We just don't know.
No saben si cuando pasa el tiempo que si nada más va a estar todo normal, así como que no va a haber más improvimiento, mm-hmm. O si va a seguir haciendo, para seguir progresando.
¿Tienes muchos pacientes tú ya con el tratamiento?
Dime, más
que you have a lot of patients with the treatment already?
So, me, I just moved here to Austin a few months ago, and so right now I have one patient who is on treatment, and we are working on getting a program set up here in Austin, which I hope in the next few months we'll be able to get that going.
Yeah, like a hospital.
And perhaps if those who are live streaming from home, if you are families who have children in your family with SMA, perhaps you would even be able to weigh in here. But from what I understand, just being here in Austin for a few months, it sounds like many of the patients in our SMA community have been looking for treatment in Houston and Dallas, and I think perhaps San Antonio has just started up, but I can't confirm that, I'm not sure. So we're hoping to also be able to get this going soon for our patients locally.
Nobody commented, so.
People are being quiet.
There's some monitoring that's done while patients are getting dosed with the medication. We've looked for low platelet counts, protein in the urine, and looking for any kidney toxicity. These were all things that were generally, or found more strikingly, with the general category of medication in which nusinersen is in, called the antisense oligonucleotide, and was still somewhat present in the clinical trials, but not a major theme. So I think it still has to be seen, and just maybe with more experience, more patients on it, we may have an idea. But this is the kind of sort of monitoring that a patient might expect to be going through while they're getting this
medication.
And this is, again, just to emphasize that this is not a cure, that there's still a lot of work to be done for our patients to support them even when they're on the medication. So just real quickly, because we're kind of getting to time here, future treatments, there are some clinical trials that are getting set up, not just in the US, but also in Europe, to look at gene therapy, which is like a gene replacement. So, you know, you, if you have SMA and you have typos in those SMN1 genes, let's just give you a brand new, fresh SMN1 gene. And viruses, although can sound scary, actually have a mechanism to insert genes into our DNA, and you know, maybe we could sort of use that as a way to get brand new genes into ourselves.
Is it in human trials now, or is it still? It is actually in human trials. Oh wow, that's very cool.
And then well, we may not go into the other things. There are several other very, very novel, very interesting treatments that are being developed. And I sort of anticipate that perhaps we might come up with some kind of cocktail for our patients, you know, a little bit of you know, this that could help with this particular part of the mechanism, and maybe a little bit of this that could help. And so it's going to be very, very interesting, very exciting to see how this evolves over time. And I think the really incredible thing is that it's, you know, this story is probably not isolated to SMA. You know, it's incredible because this is the first thing we have for this otherwise fatal condition. And, you know, this is potentially changing how we think about, you know, other conditions that the rest of our population deals with, you know, and think of other genetic conditions, or maybe even, you know, type 2 diabetes, or, you know, breast cancer if it's a genetic cause, or so it's really, really very exciting. Anyway, so I've got a summary here, but I think you guys have heard me talk plenty. Do you guys have any questions? I don't know how much people are interested in references, but
you have a lot.
I learned a lot.
Oh, you said you have a lot. Was there another question that someone had asked that I said I was going to go over, or did I?
You did.
Okay.
I was asking about the shot. How often do you get it? So
Thank you so much for bearing with me. I know that's a very complicated technical thought, but I think it's so incredible. And I think it has implications not just with SMA, but really with a lot of conditions that we see, you know, in neurology, and then even really far beyond that. So hopefully things will be very different, you know, 10 years from now. It could be really cool.
Thank you so much.
Thank
that
you.
Was great information. And thank you, Amrani, for translating too. Well, interpreting. So translating's written, right? Interpreting is basically.
Yeah.
I'm learning the difference. But thank you. Thank you, both of you guys. This was great. I'm going to stop. Everybody has been quiet at home.